So let's go as soon as possible to discuss fossil fuels and their viability for as a development tool for low-income countries. A critical issue in my working life. I spend a lot of my time looking at some of the lowest income countries, and I was thinking as I was reading this report that Glada and Siân are going to be pronouncing, which I think most of you have already seen and possibly got a copy that Chatham House produced in June, Left Stranded, Extractive Led Growth. And amongst the many interesting things that I've found it, I started the thesis in it that development agencies have linked part of their futures and the actual support that they're providing to extractive industries, partly because those poorest countries, extractives is all they've got. And apart from clearly the ethical issues that one can discuss about that, the report also made the very interesting observation that while in the last 20, 30 years in the commodities cycle, the poorest countries have gained much of their income, for good or often for ill, from the extractive industries, now is the current commodities downturn in the price cycle actually creating a situation in which the countries cannot think, well, we're just going to bounce back, we're in a low price scenario forever, and therefore they actually find themselves in a situation that even if they do want to break out of natural resource dependence, they're going to find themselves having to do that in a much lower income situation. And I was reading this and I got to thinking that I started thinking my way down the west coast of Africa and all the old wolves who run those polities along there, and people like Denis Sassou and Nguesso, Chantosh and Angola, all these men, and they are all men, who have lived their ways through two or three really bad commodities downturns, which had remarkably potentially powerful political consequences, and they've lived through them. And the potential, actually, that Theodore Chantosh coming to the end of his rule, your Sassou and Nguesso, that they're actually going to find themselves in a situation where the upturn that they've been trying to live their way through isn't going to happen. And that is a pretty explosive, speaking as a political scientist, a pretty explosive outturn. We've already seen the violence in the elections in Gabon over the other week, which people are also linking to the oil price. Now, we've got a really big panel, so I'm going to shut up. The way we're going to do it is Glada and Siân from Chatham House are going to present the paper. They have about 20 minutes. We then have Ekpen Omonbude from the Commonwealth Institute, who's going to comment over 8 minutes. And we then go on from that. We truly have a good-sized panel here, to two representatives of development agencies that have been working in the natural resources. We have Nicola, Barnfather from DFID, and Peter Stigset from NORAD. So we're going to have to move at some pace. I'm going to get off the stage and hand over to Glada and to Siân on a job share.
So maybe I'll just say a few words about Chatham House for those of you who don't know. It's can you all hear me? It's well, some people call it a think tank, some people call it a talk shop. I like to think that we do a lot of listening at Chatham House, and we've had a very strong energy program since the early 80s. Obviously, I wasn't involved then, but Siân and I both done a lot of work on extractives, investment, governance. There's been a long program of discussions with producing countries, especially with exporting, developing countries, looking at their interests, looking at producer-consumer dialogue, and looking at what we call depletion-led development. And I just wanted to say that the impetus for the work that we've done over the last year and the report that we produced was really because we started to feel a growing sense of discomfort. Something was jarring in terms of us hearing from our colleagues on the climate and environment side about unburnable carbon, stranded assets, this conversation starting to heat up about 5 years ago. And it jarred with what we were hearing in discussions with the producing countries, with professionals from the oil and gas sector, where they were both receiving, you know, encouragement and assistance from the international community in following a fossil fuel-led growth path, and also the optimism that they had about the sustainable economic development benefits that that would bring for their country. So that's my starting point. Siân is going to talk first, and I'll come in later. We're co-authors.
Thank you. So I guess I'll start with exactly what the picture we saw was. There's a range of institutions, initiatives, reports up here that don't need to be introduced in this company. But to put it bluntly, there's expectations, huge expectations around extractives-led growth. There's a development pathway on one side and increasing awareness around climate and carbon risks on the other. I think it's fair to say that extractives-led growth became the dominant development strategy for advisors and for governments in low-income, resource-rich countries through the resource boom, seeing the windfalls and the massive FDI that flowed into many of these countries. And we're all familiar with the theory of change here, that through export revenues you can bolster public expenditure, in some cases through domestic use of minerals you can support access to energy and industrialization. More so in the mining sector, it has to be said. And through doing so, you can raise human development, increase economic development, sustainable growth. There are three assumptions underpinning all of this. The first being that it's a potentially transformative opportunity, and this is the language that donors and advisors have used, and it's something that is echoed back in governments talking about once-in-a-lifetime transformative chances. The second assumption is that we now understand the resource curse and that we have the policy prescriptions to mitigate the worst, the negative economic and governance impacts associated with it, be it around transparency and EITI compliance or prudent fiscal management and the development of sovereign wealth funds, stabilisation funds. There was an assumption, certainly, that we knew how to manage this if just the capacity and the skills and the information could be built. And third, of course, is this assumption that there will be long-term sustained demand for fossil fuel resources and that it's a case of when, not if, these resources will be developed. And so we saw a rapid expansion of extractive sector advice from the World Bank to the UN agencies, the donors that are joining us here on the panel today, also international panels, advisory bodies, the Africa Progress Panel. Just a few years ago, Equity and Extractives, Kofi Annan, stated that there was good reason to be optimistic and that African nations could defy the resource curse. And again, in the private sector, IOCs, we see them describing themselves as development partners. McKinsey, Resource Revolution, if resource-driven economies use these resources well with the right policy and governance prescriptions, there is potential to lift half of the world's poor out of poverty. So huge, huge, huge statements. Of course, at the same time, a very different narrative was gaining traction amongst climate scientists, investors, researchers, and in the private sector, we see this manifesting itself as increasingly well-developed discussion around stranded assets and fiduciary duty to investors, and also some of the ethical dimensions that we discussed yesterday around fossil fuel divestment. And then at the same time, norms in international financial institutions, multilaterals, have begun shifting, and we've seen commitments from the World Bank and others away from funding the dirtiest of fossil fuels. And the striking thing is that these two conversations have taken place with little or no reference to one another, beyond maybe conversations around gas flaring and the oxymoron that is clean oil. Certainly on the advisory side, there are groups advising on extractives governance, speaking to oil and gas sector stakeholders, and then those same groups often have low carbon development and green growth specialists speaking to different advisors in different parts of the government. And the same is evident in country. Certainly Glada and I, in all of our discussions with oil and gas ministries, energy ministries, NOCs, climate change has just never come up. It's dealt with by a different part of government. And to put it simply, it has the concept of stranded assets has very little traction when placed against urgent poverty alleviation or access to energy imperatives. And I would go as far as to say that by introducing the concept of international climate change obligations in discussions in that kind of environment, you risk blowing your credibility and your wider advice offering. So we start to think about where do these two narratives conflict, where can they potentially support one another? Is it inherent that they're in conflict? And we approach this rather like an emerging producer might, in terms of what you want to do with your resource base and how it might best support your development and how you might split between export uses and domestic uses, and how your geology, your scale of resource, and what that means in terms of infrastructure requirements, price implications, all of these factors, and then how these emerging carbon constraints affect that picture on both sides. And the term carbon constraints is really, really critical here, because obviously it can be global carbon constraints in terms of Paris Climate Change Agreement. It can be very, very local. It's air quality. It's competitive economies. And obviously where the two converge is where you have a very, very strong argument or rationale for change. And we've seen this obviously in the case of China. So if you consider first how these risks manifest themselves in terms of global export markets, obviously we have the top-down climate change mitigation commitments, but there's also a range of other areas of action, increasing trends towards taxation and regulation to incorporate social and environmental damages, and also the reform of fuel price policies, so action on phasing out inefficient fossil fuel subsidies, and both of these hit demand. So we're looking at the broader picture of what's going on in key consumer markets and how that's going to affect long-term trajectories. And then on the other side of the coin, in terms of using hydrocarbon resources to power domestic access to energy, sustainable development, while there's not the same pressure, direct political pressure on these nations to constrain emissions, there's a whole host of other factors that warrant the consideration of low-carbon development alternatives, the obvious being the resource of classic resource curse impacts with the commodity price falls, but also the path dependency that is locked in when you start going down carbon and pollution-intensive development pathways. To take a quick look at the first side of the puzzle, the chart here shows the top five importers of fossil fuels in 2014. It's all data from the Chatham House Resource Trade Database, and it gives you a sense of the sheer weight of the decisions that a handful of importers make in the market. And obviously this picture is changing. There are some large producer importers having an increasing influence on this picture. But by all accounts, the NDCs are expected to account for a significant slowdown in demand. The IEA estimates suggested that if all INDC commitments were implemented, we're looking at fossil fuel demand growth slowing to a relative crawl of 0.5% a year by 2030. If you look at that in terms of the timeframes that these emerging producers are discussing their development in, the massive amounts of capex being slashed, exploration coming to a halt, and the fact that most of these projects are going to take a decade plus to come online, there's a very, very, very clear evolving risk picture. So for new and prospective producers, the question might be what markets can you economically serve and what investors can demand can you lock in, and what is the scale of that resource and its exposure, its productive lifespan and its exposure to these dynamics. And it's also worth saying a word. I know we spoke a lot about scenarios and models yesterday, but it's worth restating the importance of governments and economic advisors really understanding the assumptions behind these scenarios. The scenarios that your commercial partners are using and basing their development decisions on, what world does that reflect? All the evidence suggests there's a very, very strong argument to consider downside risks. And also what declining demand for fossil fuels looks like. Is it that gradual managed decline, or is it much more disruptive change? And how do you build capacity and resilience to that, and how do donors and advisors respond to that? The other side of the argument, of course, is at home, and what threats or assistance development of a hydrocarbon sector can grant your sustainable development visions and green growth ambitions. And it's fair to say that green growth, climate resilient development, has become a lot more prominent in all of these emerging hydrocarbons producers in terms of national discussions around your national vision, your long-term development plans, even if they're not being reflected in discussions with the oil and gas sector stakeholders that we're dealing with on a day-to-day basis. So how does it play into to different aspects of sustainable development? We know very, very well the negative health impacts of air pollution. The critical thing here is that the choice is made at the earliest stages in developing your resource base, and how you want to put that to work at home has a certain path dependency in terms of industrial processes, energy systems, transport systems, that locks in a certain path of development. And the problems are clear if you look at South Africa and coal-fired power and the role of an inefficient SOE and rolling blackouts and chronic local air pollution. Same for a lot of fossil fuel producers that have based development on cheap energy imports. Public health, urban air quality is coming under pressure. Equally, access to energy. We now know that decentralised options, off-grid, mini-grid options, are competitive with centralised power in many rural areas. It ties into promoting the sustainable use of forests, where forest wood and charcoal is a staple cooking fuel. Can associated gas and LPG have a role in displacing this and safeguarding forests and public health in the same breath? And equally, in terms of accessing new technologies and finance, one of the greatest pull factors of low-carbon pathways is around technology and finance. But how does development of the hydrocarbon sector affect your positioning in terms of those potential benefits and leapfrogging opportunities? And how does it look in relation to other sectors of the economy? We heard about fishing yesterday, but the same could be said for many other areas of entrepreneurship and new business models where hydrocarbons development, where industry crowds around the perceived advantage, it can start crowding out these opportunities. And the examples of more established producers and the difficulties they've had moving towards sustainable diversification have a lot of lessons for these countries at this stage of the discussion.
Which
is what plays
on. Brings me on to... Oops. How do I get back? Which brings me on to this story, the fossil fuel-led growth or depletion-led development. I kind of like the idea of saying depletion-led development, because when you talk to exporting countries, and who in the room, by the way, comes from a net fossil fuel exporting country? So there's a few people. Okay. So what we find is conflicting views of the role of the fossil fuels in the economic development path. But what you do have in common, this is a picture of Ecuador, is a picture whereby the production trajectory rises and so does economic growth. And at some point, the production reaches a plateau. This is much more accentuated in other models I could show you, but this is an example of how it goes. This stays at a plateau production for some time, and then it declines. Now, your perfect ideal would be to as my colleague Paul Stevens always says, not to consider the stuff below the ground as income, but rather it's an asset that you reshuffle and you swap it for sustainable economic activities and growth above ground, which hopefully outlasts your production. Now, that would be fine if you'd reached that point by the time that production plateaus. But at the same time, you've got this problem of this line here, which is domestic energy consumption, which is usually growing pretty fast, because the thing about fossil fuels, you know, in comparison with mining activities, is that you can also use them as an input to the domestic economy, and that can fuel growth too. And countries want to do that, and they often want to give incentives to do that by obviously keeping the prices low enough to incentivize, a high carbon pathway of industrialization. But the problem with that is it starts to squeeze your exports. And we're not even talking about what's happening in the global market with pricing, but it begins to squeeze your exports. Even Saudi Arabia is worried about this issue. So as your production plateaus, your domestic consumption grows, your exports are squeezed, you become more and more worried about what's happening in global markets, and you also become more concerned about potentially your spending on subsidies domestically, your pollution, your competitiveness, if infant industry, you know, has not grown up in time to be competitive without huge subsidy. So there's a few of the issues that we hear exporting countries talk about a lot. This is very much of concern, how to reach a sustainable transition by the time, you know, your production plateaus. Now, there are some success stories of diversification, economic diversification, say in Mexico, Malaysia, Indonesia. But I think it's important to realize that those countries have had a long experience whereby, you know, they only began that diversification process when revenues began to, when the resource revenues began to decline, and only with like intensive incentives for high productivity, for technical transfer, for skills growth. So, and institutions obviously being key to this, and that's a luxury that many low-income, low-capacity countries don't have. One of the most compelling examples we found when we were talking to our stakeholders was the example of Trinidad and Tobago, which followed a vision for natural gas development. It really took into account that they were not going to become dependent on just selling a raw material to the market and being totally dependent on the price and foreign demand for that. They were going to build a national industry, petrochemicals, steel, building the linkages with the local economy. This is a very, very powerful story for other producers. I think the question is today that TNT, in spite of its success, is really in a race against time to bring down energy intensity, increase productivity, develop a knowledge economy. And that's become very tough because of the industrial pathway it's chosen. So it was a good decision in the 60s and 70s, maybe 80s, to travel down this path of fossil fuel-less growth. Is it still the same question? Is it still this? Is it still valid in today's context? Just a few more examples I'll flick through. The options today look very different. We would say there are essentially four pathways on the table, you know, in terms of the options that countries have. They do have options, and the question for assistance is, international assistance, is that actually obscuring other potential development choices? Has it actually been aligning with industry interests in developing as fast as possible to maximize profits, also with potentially with kleptocratic elites who want to take as much money as fast as possible from the resources? And so in this case, we were talking around four scenarios, you know, the potential rush to market, which could be, you know, we heard in one of our sessions where we did have someone involved in national strategy in one of the African countries say, we want to use the money from fossil fuels to develop our, you know, green sustainable economy. We want to take that money. So, you know, is the best plan for them to rush to market, use that money effectively? That very much depends on the capacity to manage those revenues effectively, and also the very high risk of the resource curse effects, which you all know very well. Development on parallel tracks, this is something that countries like Mexico are pursuing, you know, that you can develop your fossil fuels while taking action on a low carbon development pathway at home. It does require political resolve, may require moving a bit more slowly, a lot of assistance, pushing back on public expectations, I think, to maximize revenue. And then we talked about pace development, much slower, much more in line with your capacity to capture the economic benefits from that sector. And also In this sense, the pace development model would give a country the chance to monitor the market, what's happening in the market, and pace the development in line with that. Obviously, very tough. Would need a lot of help in political resolve. And then the focus on the non-extractive sectors. When a country has a choice to develop extractives or not, you know, or to expand a project or not, to develop a new project, there is a choice not to develop. And in fact, there's a very interesting example going on in DRC right now in the Virunga National Park, whereby I think DFID is supporting a model which says, okay, if you don't develop the oil in the Virunga National Park, we'll assist you with developing tourism, renewable energy, and agriculture, which will provide more jobs and give you the same benefits that the oil would have had. But there is pressure to show that those benefits from that pass to society. How is low-carbon development meaningful in low-income context? I think Siân's talked a bit about this, but we did want to just point out that these are the three areas. If you look at the INDCs of countries like Ghana, Ethiopia, Kenya, Tanzania, Mozambique, they focus on diversifying the energy mix, definitely increase of renewables, obviously, you know, increasing energy access in the cleanest possible way, forests, large scale agroforestation, forest, you know, increasing the sustainable use of forests. In fact, we were talking to some Ghanaians the other day, and they said if only some of the oil wealth could be earmarked for afforestation from the oil wealth, you know, that would be a really good way of making the wealth sustainable for future generations, for building that value. And transportation, you know, how to develop systems that work for both maximizing the linkages in the economy, bringing goods to market, but doing that in a way that does not increase pollution and lead to the health impacts you're seeing now in Delhi or Beijing. We think that energy and industrial policy can really act as a bridge between these visions. We think there was a very salient report that came out by UNECA in I think April, and it made the point that it was about greening industrialization in Africa, and it was saying that decisions today will have long-lasting impacts on growth and consumption. So getting it right first time is vital to avoid retrofitting, which is always more expensive. I think it's a really salient quote when you come to talking about industrial development and energy, what kind of power stations you want, what kind of secondary manufacturing type industries you want to build, what are you also losing at the same time, and what might you need to retrofit in future. So with that in mind, we wanted to really talk about putting options back on the table for extractors, producers, fossil fuel producers. We wanted to think about how can new information perhaps open up narratives that have been obscured by the fossil fuel-led growth or extractive-led growth narratives, and how can that lead to a more constructive discussion whereby the givers of assistance, the MDBs and the donors, can actually reconcile their commitment to a 2-degree or 1.5-degree world and green growth, and their commitment to helping countries to develop, you know, in the best way for them. So, I think this is really key. The questions that happened before the decision to extract, in terms of the full cost and impact of extraction, I think that's often lost, you know, especially in terms of not only the pollution impacts, but impacts on water use, impacts on environment, biodiversity, what are the opportunities for domestic sustainable development that might be jeopardized by the oil activities? I think Nima mentioned fishing in Ghana yesterday, which is a very salient example. And you know, how does the extractive sector development model interlink with the sustainable national vision? I think they're definitely pricing, how you price energy domestically, how it comes into the economy is extremely important. And the questions after the decision to extract, or for those countries already in the midst of development, you know, there's a question of balancing between exports and domestic use of resources, the role that resources can play in sustainable energy and energy access goals. Where are the institutional and regulatory checks and balances to ensure that policy is focused on the ends rather than the means? I think this is an area that assistance givers could focus on much more in the case of not locking in negative vested interest, but actually locking in a positive institutional vested interest that will help assist countries in making that transition to a more sustainable pathway. And infrastructure. I think infrastructure flexibility, a lot of money goes in up front when you develop fossil fuels, there's a huge amount of capital employed, everybody wants infrastructure to really kickstart their economy, but can this be built in a way that you don't have to retrofit 10 years later, that it doesn't lock in high carbon growth? And can the development of hydrocarbons offer co-benefits? I think the skills and the local content conversations that we have become very relevant here. And how can the co-objectives be better incorporated into decision-making? And I think this really revolves around getting people from the national strategy areas, the ministries of environment and energy, and oil and gas around the table together, because they don't always speak the same language even within one country. Thank you.
Thanks very much. There's actually an interesting listing of of which ministries are involved in the environmental climate change agenda, and it did strike me that in the actual political structures, you're looking at often the weakest structures actually with the climate change agenda, and the strongest ones looking at oil. Ekpen, I think you're going to come and make some comments on the paper, and particularly, I suspect, about the balance of forces and carrying it ahead with development. Over to you.
Thank you, John. Morning, everyone. I missed deliberations yesterday, so I had the impression that we weren't going to need slides. I have Siân and Glada to blame for that. And it would have been particularly helpful at least to have something with a logo on, so you could at least get the name right. It's the Commonwealth Secretariat. It's a voluntary organization of 53 members, 53 independent states. And what we try to do is articulate the political, democratic, and development interests of all of these states. We comprise some of the smallest countries in the world, like Nauru, and some of the largest countries in the world, like India. We've got a division that has spent the last three or so decades primarily focusing on some of the issues that have been raised by Glada and Siân, which is the narrative or the argument that the extractives would be a very powerful, transformative solution to the economic development question. But just to contribute to this, and I think I've got only 8 minutes or thereabouts.
Certainly.
I'd just like to say three things. One is that in the last year, or give or take two or three on top of that, the Commonwealth Secretariat has started to speak more in the language now of the SDGs, particularly, if we could identify some, the seventh goal, the 12th, and the 13th, and I'll elaborate on them very briefly. Goal seven speaks more to access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, modern energy. Now, what we recognize is this tension, what we recognize is this potential conflict, and we're trying as much as possible to infuse a lot of the sustainability into the advice that we give our member states. So as far as access to affordable, reliable and sustainable energy is concerned, there's one very simple objective that we've got, which is to try and increase the share of renewable energy in the energy mix for our member states. Now, what we have done in this case now is to try and fit it into our existing business model, which is essentially two things from our side of the house: help with policy and help with the implementation of it. Now, on the policy level, we are looking at things for our member states such as choice of technology and then the fiscal and financial incentives. And then also trying to help on the implementation side, looking at taxation, for example, the extent to which you can go down under the bonnet, if you like, and work through accelerated depreciation just to provide incentives for such schemes. And then on the more practical side of things, we continue with our business model, which is to support with the agreements, the legislation, and then where possible, capacity building. So that's goal seven. And goal 12 of the SDGs, and I'm trying to speak the SDG lingo here, which is to ensure sustainable consumption and production patterns. That speaks more directly to the work that we've done over the years, helping with legislature, regulations, policies. But what we've started to do now is to infuse more sustainability, if possible, into it. And what we have started to do more recently, which interestingly seems to tie in with the scenario that we've got, but we've just got a slight variation to it, is we've started to look at, for our small island developing states, blue growth, ocean governance scenarios. And we've started a, I can't call it a pilot project, but we started with the government of the Seychelles. And we've said to them, look, there are four possible scenarios that you could start to look at critically now. One is to leave things as they are. The other is a sort of slow and steady development, which will start leading towards gradual decarbonization. One which they seemed to fancy is a true transformation, which would then look at scenarios such as taking hydrocarbon revenues and then investing them in climate change mitigation activity. And then the final one is where you can reach a stage where you're confident enough to make a policy choice, leave it in the ground, and focus on more sustainable activity. The biggie for us, especially in light of things that have happened in Paris last year, is Goal 13, taking urgent action to combat climate change and its impacts. Now, this is an important component of our work, especially from the advocacy standpoint. And there are two initiatives that we've started to develop. One is a proposal for a multilateral debt swap for climate action. To try and put it as simply as possible, basically what we're trying to achieve here is to get especially small member states who are burdened with debt to have through relationships with climate finance providers such as GTF, to have some of their debt either written down or paid off completely. And then the debt stock that was meant to be repaid would then be invested in climate mitigation activities. Now, the mechanics of it can prove tricky. Some would even argue bordering reality. The other initiative that we've recently launched last year at the Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting was to establish a Commonwealth Climate Finance Access Hub. Basically, again, to fit into our business model of trying to help our member states do some of the more practical things. So here we're trying to assist our member states with navigating the existing climate funds, with preparing proposals, complying with eligibility criteria. And it will be hosted, my understanding is, in Mauritius. And the idea is to have in-country a number of climate finance advisors who would handhold many of these countries through these activities. And so far, and it will lead to the second point that I'm going to make here, it's taken a bit of interest with about 13 of our member states, 4 from the Pacific, 6 from the Caribbean, and 3 from Africa. The 3 from Africa are quite interesting in terms of the profile of size and where the countries are. It's Mauritius, it's the Kingdom of Swaziland, and it's Namibia. That have generated this interest. But it leads to the second point that I was going to make here, which is the kind of support that our member states are currently asking for, even given all of what's going on. And this is where things start to get a little bit awkward, because I'll just reel to you a summary of some of the requests that we get for assistance, especially with this side of work that we do. In the last year, we've gotten requests to help with negotiations with IOCs. We've gotten requests to help with the development of sovereign wealth funds and other revenue management mechanisms. We've gotten requests to review or develop petroleum and mining legislation, regulation, contracts, and the like. We've gotten requests for the review of petroleum and mining policy. More recently, we've started to get requests for ocean governance policy and blue economy strategies, speaking to what I said earlier about what we're doing with the Seychelles. And then we assist our member states with the delimitation of maritime boundaries and extension of continental shelf submissions. So none of this particularly reflects the reality or the challenge of climate change. However, we try to infuse or integrate the SDGs into these requests as they come. So a lot of the work that we're doing in this regard now is more at the advocacy level, because we are a request-based organization, mind you. So we're driven by what our member states want us to do. And the third point that I'm going to make is that on the basis of the kind of requests that we're given, on the basis of the interactions that we've had with our member states, it's not particularly clear to us that the countries have fully grasped the implications of these commitments that many of their seniors are making. And I'll just give an anecdote. I'm not going to mention the name of the country. Southern Africa is landlocked, so there are not many there. I was over there about 2 months ago trying to help them out with the development of their mining policy. And I noticed, again, I suppose it's one of the things that we encourage them to do, which is take ownership of the document after we've done the first few drafts. I noticed that there was a marked difference between the draft that we had done in London and what I saw when I got on there. And the big difference in there was coal. So I said to them, you do realize that your president in Paris stood confidently and made commitments and specified some of the areas where there was going to be focus on climate change action. And one of the specifics was coal. Now, here you are putting your policy forward and hinging your power generation future on coal utilization. I can't get the accent right, but what the permanent secretary said to me was, brother, we have to feed. Just to give sort of context to it. So there are a number of these challenges or harsh realities or awkward realities that we tend to see. Now, the observations that we've made is that there's definitely not that multi-stakeholder consultation or conversation intra-government about these things. There's a complete disconnect in the discussions. We've also noticed that a big factor is the fuel intensity or even some of the non-fossil fuel activity that they intend to pursue for industrialization. A key example is mining and the power generation implications, for example, of pushing through limestone for cement and construction work. There's also the infrastructure question. Most of you have seen all of the data available. I mean, one of the ones that goes around is that I think it's sub-Saharan Africa has about 200 kilometers per 1,000 square kilometers of land for roads, only 25% of which is paved. Now, when you say to developing countries, especially the members that we deal with, that if you want to push through your rapid industrialization, these are some of the implications for the use of fossil fuels. There's a tendency for some, I don't want to use the word resistance, but there is that sense that we get. Funding is an interesting challenge, which is one of the reasons why we've tried to come up with as many solutions as possible, such as the finance hub and the debt swap proposal. And just to conclude, I guess certain points to make, there's a mismatch between the high-level intentions and the practical preparedness at country level. And then there doesn't seem to be enough of that natural incentive available to these low-income countries to take things up. I'll stop ranting there.
Thank you very much. So, I suppose we're here with the climate change side of things and the climate change narrative that has come on. And we're coming out of the extractive narrative, but the fact is the extractive narrative, extractive for development, remains absolutely central in a lot of agencies' thinking. So let's hand over to Nicola and hear the view from DFID.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I'm just going to do a very quick presentation. I crumbled yesterday. I didn't have a presentation, but I did see the kind of layout, so I've pulled together a few little slides. So I work for the Department for International Development, which is a UK government department. Just a bit of background. DFID made a commitment, the UK made a commitment to spend 0.7% of gross national income of the UK on overseas development. I think we're still the only country to have reached that challenge, and it has been a significant challenge, which is around £11 billion a year in 28 countries. We tackle the root causes of extreme poverty. That's the kind of ultimate strapline what we're trying to achieve. But we do have some conflicts within our portfolio, and as an extractives advisor, I'm probably at the sharp end of that. We work on economic development and wealth creation, but also preventing climate change and encouraging adaptation and low carbon growth. I'll just whiz through this. We have a pretty significant extractives portfolio. We've got a central policy and regional programming team, which I sit in. That offers central funding and support to the extractives industry's transparency initiative, Natural Resources Governance Institute, the Africa Legal Support Facility around contracting support for contract negotiations and addressing those power imbalances that we see around legal discussions, and a skills programme, SOGA, in East Africa around the oil and gas sector. We're developing a new programme, Great for Partnership, which is about using UK public sector skills and partnering them with counterparts in developing countries. Part of the scoping for that was looking at the demand side in three countries in Africa. And just to say that, again, from extensive interviews, which DFID didn't lead, at no point did climate risks come out of the demand area for support. So it really isn't something that's on the agenda. We also have country-level programmes where extractors advisors in country deliver significant extractors programming, which generally focus on government capacity building, civil society capacity, so that there is capacity to hold government and private sector to account, and also private sector development. On the climate portfolio, we look at trying to help countries transition to climate smart future. And we have got a cross Whitehall position to end support for the public financing of new coal-fired power plants overseas, except in the most rare of circumstances with the poorest countries with no real alternatives. But since that policy came into position, we've never actually funded anything. And
the biggest challenge for us, which I think has been outlined already by the speakers today, is just this trying to bring these portfolios together around extractives-led growth, especially where hydrocarbons, we're talking about hydrocarbons, but also our ambitions for countries to achieve low-carbon growth pathways. Yes, we do talk as donors along the lines of, you know, this potential graduation from aid, you know, UK taxpayers' money being spent in developing countries, and we really ultimately want countries to be able to be self-sufficient, and we see fossil fuel revenues as a way potentially for them to achieve that, but we are very, very well aware of the risks. But there is a genuine concern that countries may lock into carbon-dependent energy provision and infrastructure once fossil fuels have been discovered. You know, there are many countries that we work with that have got very significant ambitions around low carbon development and green growth ambitions and commitments that they've made. But once fossil fuels have been found in significant quantities, how does that disrupt those commitments? You know, we've seen issues in Tanzania where that potentially could be an issue with the gas finds. Ethiopia, we haven't had any significant finds there yet, but they could be next in terms of fossil fuels. In terms of oil, and what might that mean for their green growth commitments that have already been made. So it is very disruptive once fossil fuels have been found. We do have organisational and policy silos in the UK in terms of trying to work more closely with extractives and low carbon emissions in one programming or policy vehicle. It's a challenge, but it's a challenge overseas as well, and we need to try and kind of at least build a narrative as a first step. And for us, getting in our energy policy framework, we now have a commitment to provide upstream advice on extraction. So we've always said that the decision to extract is a sovereign decision, but actually we should be provisioning advice to help support that decision in terms of the long-term risks, which is why we've been working really closely with Chatham House and UCL to kind of look at some of the scenarios around that. I would say that Glada and Siân have produced a really excellent policy paper in this area, which I think you've got copies of it outside, so I really would recommend having a good read of that, because we really haven't had the time to go through all of the details in this quick run through. So just some very few key findings or points for me to make as well. You know, in terms of working with low-income countries, communications and handling around the kind of narrative of climate change and climate risks, it really does need to be dealt with very carefully. Low-income countries want to see revenues from investments, and they are regionally very, very competitive with their neighbours, and they'll do, you know, whatever they can to get the deals that their neighbours may miss out on. So there is a significant disadvantage in terms of them coming to the table because they desperately want these investments. That decision to extract, as I've said, from our perspective, it's a sovereign decision, but we do feel that support is needed to help countries identify what those risks are. And I think we've all got a part to play there with which scenarios are used and how, you know, we need to get through those technical challenges but actually provide some really useful information. The narrative around stranding and leaving resources in the ground just doesn't stack up in country, as we've all said. You know, I've had meetings in petroleum departments where we even start to talk about that, and you really are looked at. We really are looked at, you know, with dismay, and it does reduce your credibility, you know, trying to kind of start that conversation. So we need to think about the language that we use, you know, especially around the West telling countries what they should or shouldn't do with their resources. That's, you know, it's not the kind of narrative that I think we need to use. Obviously, there are genuine risks to countries. The decision is theirs, but the kinds of future risks that need highlighting are around the higher running costs which could develop from a reliance on hydrocarbons, exposure to volatile markets in the future if they go down that path. And many of the countries we work in are really at the sharp end of that, as we all know, right now. Long-term energy security issues, and the work that our colleagues in Chatham House have outlined today, that was phase one, and we're looking at embarking upon a second phase of that work, which is looking at kind of in-country outreach, scenario planning, with UCL as well, involved very much in this. South-South learning, you know, Chatham House have got an excellent new petroleum producers group where we bring, you know, they bring established and new producers together to learn from each other. So it reduces that kind of perception that the West is really telling developing countries what they should or shouldn't do. Actually, it should be about countries learning from one another's experience and making informed decisions. But we have a role to play in provisioning that advice. There's also going to be, you know, we really want to kind of outreach to other donors and multilateral development banks, because again, this narrative around the kind of scenario planning and risks to countries going down a fossil fuel-led growth pathway, we just the narrative just isn't really there yet. So we really need to kind of try and build that together.
We want to incorporate some of the findings that Chatham House will be doing with UCL into our thinking on power and power infrastructure, in terms really of getting the right energy mix and scenario planning around the energy mix. Language like that is much more favourable when we kind of start our discussions in countries, thinking about kind of INDC, power and extractives commitments. It's a much easier way of kind of coining the discussion. For example, Tanzania's plans for coal, for coal-fired power stations may well be revisited once we start thinking about the kind of bigger picture in terms of their gas supplies and their intentions to kind of sell LNG to an already flooded market. Actually, they may well be better looking at their own gas for domestic consumption as opposed to export. So trying to think things, some of these challenges through with countries. I can't finish without saying, you know, in our perspective as a donor, you can't talk about the extractive sector or the power sector really without thinking about the political economy realities on the ground. The vested interests that surround the sector are very, very difficult to kind of overcome. Gaining traction is very, very challenging, and we really need to know what's going on behind the scenes before we can really think about, you know, what our interventions are going to be. They need to be very carefully planned. And we do a lot of work behind the scenes with our colleagues in the Foreign Office to actually understand a lot of what's going on in country. The promises that get made to citizens on discovery, I think some of the comments that were made yesterday were excellent. You know, big promises are made once fossil fuel fines are made, and managing those expectations and actually teaching people about what the realities of the sector might be is a really, really important thing to do. I'll try not to, finalise my comments. I think the debate needs reframing towards kind of thinking about the long-term economics, the long-term sustainability of investments, and choosing the most appropriate fuels for development needs. And kind of let's coin things in a slightly different way. I hope that was quick enough.
Thank you very much, Nicola. I think the political economy questions and the governance questions are huge. Petter, you have some comments from NORAD on oil and development? Then please join us. There we go. We're suddenly surprised where everyone came up with slides. So you should have a slide-free zone.
We had a discussion yesterday, and Nicola discovered that I'd made slides, so she had to make slides, so that's why.
They did it behind the moderator's back, you see.
Anyway, good morning, everybody. So I represent Norway, the country that used to hunt whales, and we export oil and gas. That's why we concentrate on changing the rest of the world. First of all, thank you for a very good report, a very interesting presentations. This is the first time I attend a climate conference, and it's been great. There were so many things said yesterday that really raised my awareness. Thank you all. Coming from Norway, I really appreciated the guys from Australia who talked about their coal mines larger than Manhattan yesterday. Somebody's worse than us, and I really appreciated that. I'm going to talk about the Oil for Development program, since we actually mentioned in the report from Chatham House, and I want to put a few things straight, explain what the Oil for Development program is about. The question we're faced with, I think, listening to the discussion yesterday, is we're cooperating, I'm going to come back to this, but we're cooperating with 12 to 14 countries around the world, developing countries. And the question we're faced with is, these countries, our partner countries, will they be stuck with stranded assets? And I think the most interesting questions, as far as what I'm concerned, is who shall be in a position to sell the last cubic foot of gas or the last barrel of oil? Should it come from the Barents Sea, or should it come from Tanzania, for example? So anyway, Oil for Development, we started actually 40 years ago when countries approached Norway asking for assistance with governing their petroleum resources. We've been working with Mozambique for more than 35 years, doing capacity building and helping them all along the way, and we're still there and they still need assistance. I think it's important to emphasize that the program is recipient-driven. It's based on requests coming from countries, formal requests from countries coming to Norway, asking for assistance. We don't promote extractive-led growth, which is actually mentioned in the report. think that's quite important. The program, and I think I included this slide because I think it's important as well. This is how the program is governed on the Norwegian side. It's actually owned by a set of ministries. We have the Ministry of Oil and Energy, of Petroleum and Energy. We have the Ministry of Climate and Environment owning the program as well, influencing the decisions and the strategic direction of the program. The Ministry of Finance, the Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Labour and Social Affairs. We cooperate closely with the Auditor General in Norway. They also have programs in more or less in the same countries as we do, with the Auditor Generals in the countries. We coordinate with EITI. We have just signed an agreement with UNEP, UNEP, on climate and environment issues. So we expect to be working closely with them. But my point here is that there is a checks and balances in the internal governance of our system, or the program. Now, the overriding point of the program, any development aid program in Norway, is of course poverty reduction, which is, as far as I'm concerned or we're concerned, is way beyond the horizon. So we have set an operational goal, which is responsible management of the petroleum resources, saying that if you want petroleum resources to contribute to poverty reduction, a prerequisite is responsible management of the resources and competent institutions. It's not sufficient. There are a lot of other factors, of course, but this is what we're concentrating on. And we divided that into three sub-goals. We assist the countries with a political and legal framework, regulatory framework, petroleum policy, petroleum laws, revenue management, etc. This is normally the first thing we do. It takes a few years. And then we have the ones that are going to govern the resources need to be competent. And that's a long-term thing. And it's based on institutional cooperation between Norwegian civil servants working together side by side with civil servants from Ghana, from Mozambique, from Tanzania, from Lebanon, in a twinning type arrangement, which builds mutual respect and good cooperation. That's the foundation of the whole thing. And the last one is working with civil society. It's what we call a third sub-goal. Civil society, journalists, media, parliamentarians, they are the ones that are supposed to keep the authorities accountable for the way they manage the resources. In other words, the whole thing is about developing an informed public and an informed institutions. Now, these are the countries in which we're in at the moment. Altogether, we have been in about 35 countries. We've completed them several. We're in 14 countries now, more or less. We have requests from Somalia and we have a request from Colombia. Normally, from the request arrives until we actually start a program, it takes about 2 to 3 years. Where we work very closely with the partners in the countries. So Somalia and Colombia is in the mapping phase. It just started. In the planning phase, we have Kenya and Myanmar. We're ready to start in Myanmar probably from early 2017. Kenya a little bit further out. And these are the countries where we are at the moment. And there's one thing I would like to mention. All of these countries except Iraq are signatories to the Paris Agreement. They have commitments to the climate change. And I think two of them have also ratified, which I think UK hasn't, the agreement. Tanzania, and I've forgotten which one the other one is. But so these are the countries we're working with. Most of them we've been in for a long time. I always say to people when we talk about oil for development that if you don't like dilemmas, don't work with oil for development. We're faced with dilemmas absolutely all the time. And the effect of that, working in the program with a very clearly defined goal, is that it becomes more sophisticated, you learn along the way, and you absolutely realize that nothing is black and white. And there's nothing, never any really, really simple solutions to anything. So there is an ongoing debate in this large, the first slide I showed with all the institutions involved, but what is the right thing to do? I mean, it's all from unsavory political decisions or political situations in countries. to, as we talked about, climate issues and environment. But I would like to say, referring to some of the things that were said yesterday, if we hadn't had an oil for development program, the situation in around Lake Albert would have been a lot worse than it is now. I think it's a world-class exploration going on in western Uganda. I think the risk for the Ghanaian fishers would have been worse if we hadn't been involved. Basically, it's all about we working on resource management, environmental management, revenue management, and health, safety, and environment. So it's a very comprehensive program, and I think basically you're lifting the competency up, raising the competency in the organization with whom we're working. And it's all about enabling them to make informed decisions. So as to the questions about, I'll finish now. I have so many important points to say. But anyway, the thing that there is a conflict between what we're doing and the green growth or the shift, green shift, I disagree with. So we have a slight disagreement on that. I think you have to do both. The world is a complex system, and step changes and abrupt changes, I don't believe in them. You have to do both, and we do both. Other parts of Norwegian development aid works on hydroelectric power and things like that. So, I have so much more to say, but I feel the nervousness on the left-hand side here. So.
I'm not nervous, so. But we can go. Over many years, I've been asked by African officials, actually, particularly as they were starting to get an oil industry going, what should we do? And actually, my standard response has actually always been, call the Norwegians. So we have a little bit of time. The organisers have thankfully allowed us to run on just by a little bit. So has anyone got any pressing questions they would like to ask on this? Yes, there's just in the middle, just over there, and then we've got one right up at the top in the middle and one in the middle there, and we'll do three quickly. Thank you.
I'm Michael Ross. I'm a professor at UCLA and also here at the Blavatnik School. I've studied this issue for a long time and done a lot of empirical work and data analysis. And one thing that strikes me about what most of the panelists suggested was that we kind of know what the right policies are in order to bring about a more diversified pathway to growth. And that the problem really is sort of helping persuade the governments of these countries to adopt those right policies. And I'm truly not sure that we do. This is an extremely rare event to see a country move towards this more diversified pathway. I think this was mentioned briefly in the Chatham House presentation that it's actually almost only been observed in the cases where countries are truly in the depletion phase. So I just wondered if any of you had anything that you could sort of say that would boost my confidence that, in fact, if countries adopt the right policies, they will indeed move towards greater economic diversification, less dependence on oil.
Thank you. Is the next one just there?
Yep, thank you. Harold Winkler from the University of Cape Town. Been a little bit puzzled also yesterday and this morning by the focus on the fossil fuel rich developing countries, and this morning the low income countries. Yesterday, Simon Caney talked about that, but today I would have thought the real core interests, and I come from South Africa, not a low income country, were really in development and adaptation, and I heard very little about that. So could you say a little bit more about ideas about the fossil fuel industry taking responsibility for adaptation, how that fits in with the agenda of this conference as well? There was a call by many, a letter signed by many prominent people, Bill McKibben and many others, calling for a carbon levy, which was expressed as a levy on global fossil fuel extraction that will ensure that the people who face the worst impacts are compensated by those who've caused the problem. That's on the adaptation side, which I really didn't hear mentioned. And And mitigation is not even the way we usually think about it. And I'm a mitigation researcher. I didn't really hear anything about avoided emissions, not getting the emissions high to reduce them later. And that really does raise a question of who effectively pays for that. So if I could hear a bit more about that as well, please.
Thank you. We've got one up at the top. And there's a gentleman with a microphone here. So if you want to ask first, sir.
Thank you. Nimo Batsi, Nigeria. I found a number of contradictions, especially when it was said that emerging hydrocarbons countries are locked into the part of low carbon development. I don't agree. I would like to see the evidence for that, because each of these countries are actually setting up infrastructure and doing all they can, including political conflict. Political and other conflicts to invest in and extract fossil fuels. So I think that's problematic. And then just on the side, when my brother was speaking about the Commonwealth Secretary, I was wondering, what do we need the Commonwealth for? What do we see in this colonial reminder of things that should be long gone? And then they go out helping people, helping nations. I think this is really hypocritical. And finally, my final point is that I do agree with Nora, because I've had experience in following the oil extraction activities in Uganda. It is a very difficult situation. They have the oil wells on the rim of Lake Albert. That cannot be world-class extraction. We have a system of build-up military in the area and all the conflicts coming up. And I just agree that more work needs to be done, and your support for the work, especially with civil society, is very critical in that respect.
We got, certainly Lake Albert was a tough place, because on the Congo side they actually had the initial geologists were shot, weren't they? Last question.
Thanks. Kimi Chan with the Nature Conservancy. This is really a bit more of a qualitative question. You know, if you look at the demand side and supply side approaches, there are problems with both. You know, on the demand side, probably the key issue is that you have economic development so closely correlated with increases in energy consumption and fossil fuel consumption, and then on the supply side, the big pushback there is leakage. So I'm just curious if anybody wants to weigh in on which issues kind of if they're equal or if one overrides the other.
Okay, now we probably will only have time for that one round of questions. Who would like to go in first with those? Where shall we go? Okay, let's go.
Ekpen,
there's no one. It's a hot
thing. Okay, I will jump in, but I can. on the diversification question, it's a difficult one to answer, and I think I can probably say that I'm not going to be best placed to answer that. It's not an area that I work on in my portfolio, and so hopefully, as we get down the line, we might have some additional comments to make on it. I just want to say that one of the comments that was made about the not believing that emerging hydrocarbon producers are also locked into low carbon development. I think that was a misunderstanding. It was probably my fault because I was rushing through my presentation so quickly. What I was trying to say is that countries which are demonstrating really significant ambitions towards low carbon development, of which we do work with quite a number of them, what we're concerned about is once fossil fuel fines are actually reported, that what will that do to disrupt that prior commitment towards low carbon development? It's likely that ambition towards low carbon development may actually be disrupted. So that's the concern, and I apologise if it was not communicated very well. And on the development and adaptation and fossil fuel industries taking responsibility for adaptation, again, I'm not best placed to comment on that, but I will say that we organised a round table with the private sector, with the oil and gas industry and coal industry, and also investors last year, where we discussed some of these challenges around unburnable carbon and what the appropriate response should be. DFID funded it, so we brought a low-income country perspective to that, and I must say that in our experience generally around the table, the actual operators were really sitting on their hands. They didn't really see what their role or responsibility could or should be in that space. The investors were very interested to think about, obviously, the question around the burnable carbon. And I think phase two of Chatham House's work is a round table with the investor community. That tends to be where we're getting more traction from my perspective, but I'm sure there are other players that can get more traction given their entry points are different to mine. I hope that helps.
Thanks, Nicola. Maybe I'll actually respond to Petter's point about the usefulness of assistance from abroad. And we definitely think there's a role there because a lot of these resources will get developed anyway. I mean, the people, the countries that we're talking about have choices in the market. They're not just there's not a decision to be made often on whether or not to extract. So we think that ought to be better placed on the table. So in our experience, there is a role for giving assistance. It's just the questions of how to make sure that that is coordinated with the green growth goals.
Okay, I'll just touch on a couple of questions that were raised very quickly. Again, using the same excuse, that some of it is not my area of expertise, but I'll just speak on the basis of what our members are telling us. I guess the I'll start from behind. The relevance of the Commonwealth is a fairly perfectly relevant question to ask. It's one of the questions that we find asking ourselves also, but. But here's the thing, we represent the interests of, I think it's 2.2 billion people, and a great proportion of them are desperately poor, don't have any voice at the table. So I think there's still room for an avenue for the articulation of the interests of these people. That's one. The other thing is, with the kind of structure that we've got at the organization, we insist on being driven by the interests of these member states. The relationship or the dynamics of the relationship is not such that we tell them what to do. There's a lot of advocacy that comes out, of course, and advice and suggestions based on expert advice, etc. But it's usually driven the other way around. So that keeps us, we tend to use the word trusted partner, and sometimes abuse it. But I've actually lived it in the 7 years that I've worked with the organization. There is that trust, especially with some of the really, really poor, small independent, small island development states, which constitute about a third of our membership. But we can debate that further during the break. On the other points that you raised concerning the contradictions, I think I do see a point in there. Because again, using Nigeria as an example, I looked at the data for power generation, and what shocked me was the exact volume of what's being generated is also constrained. And if you speak to a number of people in the ministry at the moment now, and say to them, what I did was I spoke to regulators and I asked, what licenses have you issued for power generation? What fuel source are they looking at? And everyone's thinking gas, everyone's thinking fuel oil. So they're not necessarily thinking along the lines of climate action or fossil fuel reduction. So there is a, and I think the presentation from Glada and Siân touched on it, there's a regulatory question to answer here in terms of even how licenses are granted. On the diversification question, and so, we could be here all day. Well, I'll touch very quickly on the parting shot that was given from his presentation at the end of it. That conflict does need to exist. I think there is realistically you can only handle it on parallels. So what we try to do is again, I mentioned it earlier. I'll just reiterate: infuse some of this, and I'll give you a very practical example. When you get to the development phase and you're going through, you've submitted a development plan, one of the questions that we're trying to get our member states or our regulators to ask is to what extent the IOCs or the companies have incorporated a number of these factors into it as a condition for granting licenses.
Thank you. I think I've been told we've absolutely got to close down for coffee, but have you got an absolutely urgent thing to say?
Yeah, just one comment. In response to Michael's very, very good point, this is exactly the assumption that we know how to handle resource curse effects. When I say we, I mean the donor community and advisors, not Chatham House. That is exactly what I mean by the assumption that we have the policy prescriptions, the technical assistance, the capacity building to mitigate these. I think in reality the jury is still out. If you look at the pain that a lot of emerging producers are going through in response to the commodities price falls, it casts all of this into doubt. Most of the firm evidence around extractive support and socio-economic development are based on mining industries, the really firm indicators, which have different footprints. They've been active for decades, very, very different infrastructure development, forward-backward linkages. So it's not necessarily a direct parallel to the questions of new and prospective producers today. And the key question is how emerging carbon constraints, whether it's export market risk or what you see as your vision of sustainable development at home, how they act as risk multipliers to every one of these known risks and resource curse impacts. And that's exactly what we hope to be exploring a bit more.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry we've had to round this up so quickly. We started late. There's so much to say. I believe there's coffee.